Hello, everyone, and welcome to TFYLP, Transformers for Your Listening Pleasure, episode number 240, recorded April 2nd, 2017. I'm your host, Duron Land, a.k.a. Weird Wolf. Along with me this evening is Headmaster Don.
Hey, everybody.
And Rick Alvarez.
Please, it's the Rick Alvarez. Thank you.
A Rick Alvarez. He's a clone.
Yeah, he's a Santaran in disguise.
Yeah,
Rick 23.
He shoots all over the place, but doesn't hit anything.
No, that would be a stormtrooper.
Well, they originally started as clones, so.
Well, everybody loves a clone.
Yeah.
Remember Virulent Clones from BotCon 2005?
I actually had that set.
Yeah, I remember winning a set at the auction and selling them for like $65. So,
reason we had the Virulent Clones was because we were trying to come up with an Insecticon toy for that set. And I was on the phone with Brian Savage, and he's like, well, you know, we don't have any insects here that we can pull from. And I happened to look over in my toy room, and I just happened to have that Buzzclaw art, the box art for Buzzclaw from Beast Wars up hanging there. And I'm like, I know who we're going to use. And that's how Buzzclaw ended up being the Virulent Clones.
Well, I mean, I love that Buzzclaw just because he's like a beautiful, delicious Jolly Rancher candy come to life. In those beautiful little colors.
Yeah. It's a shame for in the BotCon 2005 set, instead of getting the RID Megatron, if we had gotten like the Beast Wars 2 Galvatron repainted as Death Source, that would have been really awesome.
Yeah, yeah. Should I tell that story or should I not tell that story?
Go ahead.
Oh, okay. All right. Well, let me just tell that story real quick. Back in the day, I was on the council assigned by Hasbro to Brian Savage to help him with Transformers. And our friend Robert Yee had come up with a concept that we put forward, and he even did a painted prototype for us. It was the Beast Wars 2 Galvatron figure, and we were going to use that as Deathsaurus in the BotCon set. And everyone had agreed on it. Everyone signed off on it. Unfortunately, Takara had misplaced that mold and the Leo Conwell mold. And that is why you have not seen those molds since their release.
Release of Beast Wars 2 Galvatron in the U.S., wouldn't it?
I believe the Hasbro Toy Shop released it.
That's right. And the Flash Leo Convoy, we got that over here too.
Yeah.
For the Hasbro Toy Shop thing.
Yeah, so that was that's why Deathsaurus ended up being. Deathsaurus was always going to be in the set, but he was supposed to be that Beast Wars 2 Galvatron figure, and unfortunately, it just didn't work out. And I gotta tell you, the prototype that Rob Yee did, he now works for Art Asylum, which is now owned by Diamond. He did an amazing job with that prototype. It just looked amazing.
I'd love to see it. That would be awesome. You know,
probably somewhere in a closet.
You know, I mean, I like the Death Source that we got because I'm kind of a fan of that mold a little bit. But the only thing is it wasn't too far off from the Megatron that we got originally out of it. I mean, the head was different, but outside Bunny of ears. That, yeah.
Yeah, you know, there's certain sometimes where I can look back personally, having been involved with that, and I didn't do all the colors for every single thing, but I can look back and say, well, that was probably a missed opportunity. That was a missed opportunity, or that could have worked better. The Deathsaurus being so close, the blue to the purple of the actual RID Megatron was a miss. I wish we had lightened that up a little bit. I could also tell you that the Shattered Glass Ricochet, which was the giveaway figure, I kind of don't know where Lanny pulled those colors from, and by the time the rest of us had all seen it was already too late to do anything about it. And the Outback, was it a Fallback from 2005, shortly after the first movie came out, Hasbro released one that was almost exactly the same to that.
Well, we
couldn't know that. That was, you know, you're talking 2005, 2007. It just you know, made the value of that particular piece, you know, go down.
Yeah.
Yeah. But, you know, I will say this. For the length of time that y'all had to get the 2005 set together, that I still think that is one of the best. It's one of the most solid sets as far as the molds, the deco choices, and it was a great value that you got that many figures.
I thought so too.
In the set, and the toe line mold that gave us our best Ironhide and Ratchet for years.
Remember, this was before Generations.
Yeah.
This was really before Generations. So it was kind of ambiguous where these characters were playing in. And in fact, that was the year that Generations was announced. I remember they showed the gray models. And I remember just the giant pop in the auditorium when they showed the gray model for Megatron in gun mode.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody had expected to ever see another gun Megatron.
I was there.
And there he was.
Just went, the roof went off the place, yeah.
Yeah, and the same thing with the Starscream when that showed up in robot mode. I think Aaron Archer had called Jerry Javoyne. Who couldn't be there at the show. You just had him on speakerphone just to hear the crowd reaction of when they first saw that Starscream in Megatron.
And that was the beginning of the huge Generations push and everything.
Yes. Which brings us to the topic of our show, which has nothing to do with what we just talked about.
Well, I was actually going to segue into that, but before we do that, I do want to apologize that we, again, last night, were not able to go live with the show. We had some casting issues. Several people were traveling, and Don
diarrhea.
Yeah, Don was shooting like a goose. And
no, I had flu type B for about a week, and I still get really winded and tired. So yeah. You know,
yeah,
I've still got a little bit of the bronchial infection, but we got a lot of allergens in the air right now. And I think that's contributing to me not getting 100% right away. But as such, we wasn't able to get the full crew together. But we're trying to throw something together tonight for you, and hope you enjoy the show. I want to also bring up our sponsors before we get too far in here. CapturePrey.com, great toys, great prices, great service, where you can save even more on domestic orders of $150 or more with free shipping. Also,
I got to say, Orson's a stand-up guy.
Yes. And also, yeah. Mega Toy Fan, you can maximize your collection while minimizing your costs with Mega Toy Fan. You can find Mega Toy Fan at the popular robot toy conventions year-round, such as Peach Toy Show, Robot Show, and TFCon coming up.
Both who names a show after themselves? Seriously.
Yes. Pete.
Anyway. Who names a show after themselves?
Also, you can follow us on Twitter at TFYLP. You can tweet us on there. Any questions, comments, or compliments? Hopefully, no complaints. You can tweet us at TFYLP. And
please drop us a line on how gorgeously tan I am. I just spent a week in Florida, and I got to say, my look is on point.
Yeah,
I mean, compared to the two of you, at least.
Yeah, well, you know, I thought I heard the Florida breathe a giant sigh of relief last week. I couldn't figure out why, but it's when you leaving and coming back up here, I guess.
Yeah, look what they farted out. Yeah.
Yeah. I came back to beautiful New England, and now there's snow outside again.
Nice tanned reflection in the snow. Also, most importantly, if you love what we do here at TFYLP and love to see us continue, we do need your help. Down there at the bottom of the screen, if you're watching us on YouTube, is a link to our Patreon page, or you can just type it in directly at patreon.com/TFYLP. You can support us on there anywhere from $1 up to $100 a month. If you love what we do, it helps us pay the server fees, upgrade fees for equipment, software, anything like that. Anything that has to do with the show helps us keep going. It gets expensive, and quite frankly, I couldn't do it anymore. So that's the way things are anymore. I mean, it just keeps getting worse and worse. So
please remember, we do this because we all have a passion for Transformers. Yes. and for toys, and we enjoy the camaraderie. So if you're out there and anything helps, it does cost money to run a show like this. And I told Duron this in private, but I'm going to say it now. I will take a cut in my salary for the rest of the year.
Well, see, in order to help the show. That's really commendable, but Don's already one-upped you by taking no pay at all.
Right.
All he wants is Band-Aids to cover up his scratches from Massey. Yeah, from all the Massey attacks.
I will say, though, while I was sick, Massey was a very good kitty. He did not go out to cry all the time, you know, cry to go out. He would get up in the bed and just sort of check on me every now and then. He would jump down. He would come back a little bit later just to make sure I was okay. So he was a very good kitty while I was sick.
Yeah. Unfortunately, my kitty is not doing so well. He's 18 years old, and I kind of half expect him to be gone any day. He's had several seizures, and I know it's sad to talk about, but he's very near and dear to my heart, and he's been a part of my life for, like I said, 18 years. Yeah. And it's really disheartening to see him this way. I've been told by many people I need to go put him to sleep, but I can't bring myself to do that.
You know, they'll know when it's time. Yeah. I had a cat. She passed away. She was 18. She everything was fine right up until like the last 2 weeks. So they'll tell you when they're getting ready, and
they just kind of
start shutting down.
Yeah, his rear legs are almost non-functional now. He pretty much drags himself around. He relieves himself virtually anywhere he's at. His litter box is like, what's that? And he barely eats. He does make it to his food bowl, he'll either nibble in it or he'll stand in the middle of it and take a dump. So it's bad.
Let's all move on to
another brighter
subject.
Yeah. Yes.
Well, Do we talk about what we've got lately? Just to play catch up. We'll skip right into the show.
No, we've got right into the. We got some stuff to talk about tonight. You know, it's something that's kind of near and dear. Ooh, contact shot, nice. Something that's actually near and dear to my heart. I'm a really big fan of it. We actually had author Jim Sorensen on several months back to talk about this wonderful book here, the Transformers Legacy Art of Transformers Packaging book. Tonight we're talking about the history of Transformers package art. And a lot of you might think, well, what's the big deal about that? Well, quite frankly, there is a big deal about package art. Usually, I don't know about you, but whenever I was a kid, that was one of the things that really caught my eye. Not only was it a cool toy, it come in a very eye-catching, interesting package. And the artwork was, even though sometimes the perspective was a little bit weird, usually came with really, really cool artwork that I would actually find myself looking at a lot, even like the battle scenes on the back of the package. I always love those. And now as... in modern days, you know, I like to do photography, and if you follow my photography, you know that I like to try to recreate some of the package art with some of my photos, and it's just something that a part of something that I love, and it's a very small part of being a fan of Transformers. And tonight we're going to look at some of the history behind the artwork of Transformers and the package art. I'm going to go to Rick here in a minute to kick off, but Don, do you have any thoughts on package art, or do we just need to kick you off right now? No, I'm kidding.
No, definitely. I have the same book over on the shelf, and even though this is stuff I've seen for many years, growing up with it, seeing it on the shelves, in the book, you sort of get a really good idea of the evolution of the package art, where we went from with G1 all the way up to, you know, through the book as we go into G2 and things like that. And it just brought back so many memories of going to a Rose's back when Rose's was the big chain to go to if you lived in the South, going to Zayre's. When Zayre's was this is long before Walmart really became the retail giant that it is. And you would just see just 30 and 40 feet of Transformers in this. It wasn't a little 4 foot section. We're talking 30, 40 feet of Transformers. Just for the folks up north, Bradley's, if y'all remember Bradley's, we had one down here for a short period of time. And just these huge sections. And this artwork was so, it stood out so much compared to a lot of the stuff at the time.
It was very prominent on the packages, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. And if you're looking, back then looking for a certain character, you would go by the artwork more than you would the name, because you knew, because the artwork was this big, about half of the front panel.
And quite frankly, until they either appeared in the comics or on the cartoon, that artwork and the bio on the back was about the only way you could actually put the character in perspective with who that character was.
And I can't tell you how many times I went to the store with my G1 catalogs trying to find, using the catalog to try to find the figure, because, you would open up the road map and say, okay, looking for the Lux Decepticons, I need shop, because it's hard to remember the names, because you had nothing to go by. This is before the internet was even anything.
It was new, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I'm talking about 84, 85, 86, 87, because I saw the Deluxe Decepticons one time in One Roses, and I didn't have any money to get them at the time, but I remember looking at the catalog and looking, okay, because I couldn't remember the names, so I was looking for the names on the catalog to find the names on the boxes. So yeah, that for me and people my age, I think the package art book was so much nostalgia. And I miss it, but with packaging, what is it, Rick? Packaging is what, 30% of a toy's total retail value?
That really depends on the price point of the toy nowadays, and also on the square footage of the space where the toys will be displayed. So a lot of toys now don't have package art. Some toys do. Back in the day, we're talking 70s, 80s. Everything had packaging art, and it was really used to sell those figures. Transformers came packaged in their vehicle mode, so you had Blaster. He was an orange and yellow box, and that artwork is what sold me on it, because it just looked like such a cool robot.
Right, and it's just nowadays you've got like robots in disguise, which is giving us some really great toys, like. I just picked up Blur, and then I've got Soundwave to open up too, as well as Skywarp. And while the front of the packaging is different, because character specific, the back, other than the instructions, everything is pretty much copy paste in many cases, which does keep the cost down. But you have no bios, and it's not like you can just go readily watch the show, because it's at a very bad time.
But there's the internet now, and we didn't have that available to us when we were kids.
Right, but I still miss the packaging being its own little universe of information about that character. Whereas, because there were several years ago that Hasbro had, I can't remember which line it was, again, it all blurs together, but when you went and took a code, and you went to the Hasbro website and put that code in, maybe it was a cyber key, something along those lines, you would get a little bio of the character or something about the character, maybe a 3D turnaround, something like that.
Was it Cybertron?
I think I'm thinking Cybertron. But to me, that just make a packaging that's for that, have your generic cross sells on the back, but make it about the character. Have a nice bio on the back. If you had to do triple languages, but make that one packaging for that character, to get a feel for him in as he was on the shelf, without having to go research the character, because that kind of took some fun away from it. But maybe that's just me.
All right. Well, let's get into it. I pulled around 30 slides together. This is just a brief history. I mean, there's 35 years of art to talk about, and it's not something you do in just one or two shows. So this is just an example of mostly G1, G2, and we can do Beast Wars and Energon and so on later. Though a lot of the art from G2 that and some G1 pieces which showed up in the Legacy book by Jim and Bill, those came from me digging around at Hasbro. You'd be surprised that a person here, a person there would have a piece of G1 artwork in their desk at the bottom, left over from the previous person who had that desk. I was the one who gathered a lot of that. I gathered a lot of the G.I. Joe art, the Transformers art. There was art from My Little Ponies, from Muppet Babies, from all over the place. And I was trying to just keep it all in one place. And unfortunately, it most of it does not exist anymore. However, I did have quite an experience in discovering some pieces like the G2 Stunicons. I don't think anyone had ever seen the G2 Motormaster or Hotspot before. There were some Action Master art, which still has never been released and unfortunately probably does not exist anymore. And there was some Action Master art of the full characters that weren't hidden by the vehicles. And I think some of that did make it into the Legacy book. I think there was more stuff that I ended up sharing with Jim, which just didn't make it into the book. Again, these images are pulled from the internet. Credit to all the wonderful sites that host them, and thank you for letting us borrow them. Let's see, should I screen share?
I've already got it screen shared right now, so if you want to...
So people are looking at my stuff already.
Yeah, they're right now. I've got the hoist up there, and I can scroll through them and...
Can you mind if I screen share it?
Okay,
well, we can do that. That way, yeah, I was planning on... I thought the images I sent you were for you to post on the Facebook page or whatever.
But, well...
So I just... Yeah, because I got a whole thing here I got to do. So how do I... I want to plus share screen. Start. Okay. Now you guys are seeing my whole thing here. Let's see if this works. Hey.
Yes.
Okay. Let's go full screen on this. Why not? All right. So... let's talk about the early art. The G1 art started before G1, just like Transformers started before G1. There are a lot of pieces which were reused from the Diaclone era. Here we see the hoist. Here's a red version with the red version of hoist, which was available in Japan from Takara. This is before Transformers existed as a brand. Now, what I discovered in working at Hasbro was that a lot of these original pieces from Diaclone, which still existed and were at Hasbro, were in fact painted right over the original. And for Generation 2, I found that several G2 paintings were done right over the original Generation 1 box art.
Oh, wow.
Which means the G1 artwork didn't exist. For example, Starscream. Now, it was either a copy or I believe it was the original. Generation 1 Starscream was painted over into the G2 version, as well as Optimus Prime and a few other ones. So looking at this hoist, this was probably originally done in red and then painted over to be green later on. Plus, you had the details of the Autobot symbol added in. As well as some gloss, and then the perspective maybe changed just a little bit.
You remember, there was no Photoshop back then, so this was all done by hand.
There was no Photoshop. This was done... the stuff at Hasbro was done on... If you're in the Hasbro building, it's kind of split down the middle. One side is the designers, the other side is like the computer guys and the IT guys and the lawyers and stuff like that. That's modern day. Back in the day, one side was the designers and marketing team. The other side was the art department. And you had people just sitting there painting. So here is the original Prowl Green Transformers.
Basically just mirrored.
Right. So it's basically mirrored. So with something like this, it's it's almost impossible to tell which one came first. You know, was it, is the Diaclone the way it's actually painted, or is it the Transformers version the way it's actually painted? This is one of those pieces that has not resurfaced, at least not to my knowledge. I'm a big fan of following the art and collecting it. I'm lucky enough to have a few pieces. So this is one of those items which I've never seen the original of, and I don't know which way it was painted.
You know, just looking at this particular image, it looks like the Highway Patrol on the legs and the Autobot insignia are the only differences that I see.
Well, you would also had to switch the police markings on the doors, correct? If you were to flip that image, they'd be backwards.
Yeah, they would be backwards.
So those would have to have been painted over. So this is just a comparison. You have your Autobot Transformers 1 on the right. You have your pre-Transformers Diaclone, Diacron on the left. And we apologize to our audio listeners. All these pictures will be available on the Facebook page, or check out the YouTube page. Here we have the pre-Transformers Trax, which was red. Yes, there was also a version of Trax that was released in red, which is very hard to get.
Road Rage.
I believe that was the Netherlands version.
Yeah.
But the box art was still blue. So the original Trax painting started off as red and most likely was the case painted over to become the blue version we know today. So that original box art painting in the red, that most likely does not exist anymore.
Well, also the difference here too is that the cannon that Trax is holding is at a different angle than in the one in the Diaclone.
Right.
So that's been completely redrawn, it looks like.
Yeah, so again, this is before Photoshop, so the art department would have taken this and structured it in a way that better suits the intended packaging for Hasbro. And in fact, you know, I'm going to go back to this one. In fact, I've seen some original G1 box art which has canvas glued on top of it and painted over.
Wow.
So definitely there were some times where they just glued canvas right onto the surface to paint over it. And then some box art wasn't reused. So you have the Big Powered, which was the Ultra Magnus pre-Transformers. You see that here on the left. And you have Ultra Magnus by Hasbro here on the right. Two completely different pieces of art. And I would say the Hasbro art department, which took over the art for Transformers, starting with some of the 85 figures, I would say that's an original piece to Hasbro there on the right.
Although I kind of prefer the Diaclone pose. That just
well, they both have their charm. Definitely the perspective and the pose of some of the Hasbro ones are questionable. Like, what angle are you looking at this with?
Yeah.
The Diaclone one is more stylized, where the Hasbro one is more of the toy came to life.
Yeah. And see, that's whenever I've been doing the photos to recreate some of these pictures, that's usually one of the biggest challenges that I run into is the fact that because some of the artwork had some perspective issues, it's like, I mean, you sit there and you study it and you're like, what direction were you supposed to be viewing this character? You know, is it, you know, it's like their hand is like really huge, but their head is like really tiny, but then their like right leg, which should be behind them, is like really big. It's like, you know, I know there's right. There's actually a page if you have the Transformers Legacy art book, where I believe they have Slingshot or Fireflight, one of the aerial bots. It shows some design notes from Hasbro on there. It's like a perspective off redo. No, it's Blades. That's what it was, Protective Bot Blades. So basically, it just said redo on it.
Yeah. And looking at this Ultra Magnus piece from Hasbro, it's like that missile on his left shoulder wouldn't really work like that, wouldn't plug into the toy that way. And it's kind of like got its own direction that it's going in versus where the arm is, versus where the head is. It's just like,
yeah.
The perspective is all wrong on this. Okay, so there's characters like Roadbuster, which was licensed to Hasbro from another company, not Takara, and I believe it was Toku Toys. If I
Don, do you know?
Off the top of my head,
it was
Takatoku.
Or Dvorak. Was it Dvorak?
Dvorak was the show it was from, but I don't remember the manufacturer. Well, thing, but
This is the piece of Hasbro artwork, and if you look on the right hand screen, you see a pre-Transformers version of this toy in packaging. Now, looking at this, I can definitely tell where they got their influence for the Hasbro art from this. I mean, to me, the pose is almost the same. It's just mirrored. They're completely different pieces of art, but I can definitely see that the Hasbro artists looked at this and decided to paint the mirror image of that pose.
Yeah, they added the shoulder cannon and put the rifle in a different pose.
Right, but if you look at the chest and the legs and even the back, you can kind of tell like that's was heavily influenced by what came previously. Okay, so there's variations in art. Most like there's variations in toys, you know, plastic colors, variations in the packaging. So there's variations in art as well. On the left-hand side, you have the original 1984 pre-rub sign Ratchet, which has the cross, the red cross on his hand. You have the 85 and beyond Ratchet, which does not have the red cross on his hand. Now, I've actually held this piece in my hand, and I believe the red cross with the white outline is actually painted on that. So I think what happened is a copy was made and they painted over the hand. I could be wrong.
They took it off the top of the ambulance, it looks like, too. It was on the 84 on the left, I'm assuming it's the 84.
Yes.
The 84, it has the cross on the side of the top of the ambulance there, as you can see, right, where it split, and it's not on the 85.
Right. Now, that happened because of issues with the Red Cross. Here's a side note talking about Ratchet and the Red Cross. The Bakon 2005 Ratchet, we could not put a Red Cross on that because of the issues with the organization known as the Red Cross. So Lanny came up with an ingenious idea of doing the reverse. So if you look at that, it's got a cross on it, but it's kind of like, it's, I believe it's the white cross with a red box around it, which still gives you kind of the same effect.
Yeah.
So there's variations in art as well, and this would be a packaging variation. The package with the red cross on the hand is, of course, the much harder to get version. Springer. All right. I wanted to talk about this particular piece because there's questions out there whether these pieces were created separately or whether they were created together. There's some people who believe, well, somebody photoshopped out the helicopter and took the time to redo the legs. That's actually incorrect because that helicopter piece is a separate piece. I've actually held that piece at Hasbro, and that's one of the few pieces which I think got thrown out after I left Hasbro. So that helicopter is huge, by the way. It's like, I think, 2.5 feet long.
Oh, wow.
Foot tall. It's a really big painting of just the helicopter. So these were done, these were two different pieces of art that were then layered on top of each other for the packaging.
And, you know, and it just goes to show you how today these images could be done so much more easily and efficiently with the use of Photoshop and everything. You know, I mean, the whole need for the actual painting and, you know, the two foot long painting. I mean, they might still do that, but, you know, then once you just scan it and put it into Photoshop and then basically just work it together that way.
Yeah, well, there's guys out there who will draw out the pencils and maybe ink it, and then they'll scan it in, and then they'll paint it in Photoshop or Illustrator or whatever program they're using. So this is really a lost art. And when we went back and did the Fall of Cybertron G2 Bruticus box set, which was an Amazon exclusive, I went back and I found one of those old artists. And I had him paint an actual painting of the Bruticus to put on the front of that box set. So that was actually a painting. That was not something that was Photoshopped or done in Illustrator. That was an actual painting that we then, it was so big. I think it was like 4.5 feet by 3.5 feet. We had to photograph it because we didn't have a scanner big enough. And then we took the photograph, put it in Photoshop, and that's how we got the image to put on the box set. I really wanted that box set to be as authentic as possible, so I had to go back and find one of the original artists.
What was that piece of artwork thrown out to? Or
Most likely.
That's a shame, because that would have been an awesome piece to have.
They pretty much just trashed my office the day after I leave, but as is customary. And it was nothing against me, it's just customary. And this, looking at this piece of art, if you go back and you look at like the Prowl, the Ultra Magnus, which we saw earlier, you're starting to get a more stylized feel of the characters. You know, this Springer piece is Hasbro's interpretation of the Diaclone art. Because that Diaclone art was used for 84, 85. Now you're getting into 86, and they're coming up with new art that's indicative of that, but it does have a style on its own, and you can tell they are different artists. Okay, here's another example. The Buzzsaw and Soundwave. These were two pieces that were done separately and then just layered on top of each other. Then you have issues such as this. We talked about variations, but this is a whole piece of art variation. On your left, you have the Hasbro version of Astro Train. On the right, you have the Takara version of Astro Train. One is more toy-etic than the other. They have very different stickers, very different coloration.
And completely different face, yeah.
Right, completely different poses. So, Don, what do you think? What is your take on this?
Well, I prefer the Takara. I think it's more dynamic. It's more, you know, it's just, I just prefer it between the two. Although, there for the longest time, finding that white Astro Train was, you know, almost impossible without shelling out a ton of cash until they did an Encore reissue. I think it looks like the Hasbro artwork was trying to make him look more evil as a Decepticon, kind of. Like, grr, I'm going to get you. And
perfect. I'm glad you brought that up, because that's a very good point. Where the Hasbro one is more toyetic, the Takara one looks more like a character, which harkens back to the original Diaclone era art. Now, Astro Train was not one of those triple changers that was released prior to Transformers. He was intended to. So, it's my belief, just looking at the face and the wings of the Takara art for Astro Train versus the Hasbro one, that this was a piece of art that was created for that pre-Transformers era, which was then used many years later for the Transformers, since Astro Train was never released in the Diaclone line, because at that point, Hasbro and Takara had come to an agreement to create the Transformers, and that pre-Diaclone Astro Train was canceled.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Don.
No, I was just going to say, the Takara version, if it wasn't for the Decepticon symbols on the wings, in those colors, you would almost think he was an Autobot for some, you know.
Like Mock Tackle or something, maybe.
Yeah, definitely. With the bright reds, the blues, other than the red visor, but there's Autobots with red visors now. So it's just, you know, again, you know, like I said, you know, the Decepticon, the Hasbro art, they were trying to make him more evil looking. Whereas I think the Takara, with him being if you took off the Decepticon symbols, that would be, you know, you really couldn't tell if he was good or evil. I would lean to him being an Autobot.
Right. Well, remember, you're right once again. Hasbro's making him gray and purple. Those are bad guy colors. Where Takara is making him look black and white, which was the actual colors of the space shuttle at the time.
Now, this is another example too of I know the American version was also a layered piece of art, because the American triple changers always depicted the robot mode and the alt mode that was not portrayed as the toy. Like Springer, you had the robot mode and then the helicopter in front of the robot mode in the package art. And then the toy came packaged in car mode. So you could see all three modes right there. Was the Takara one layered as well?
You know, I don't believe it was. I think on the packaging, and it's been a long time since I've seen the packaging. Maybe one of you guys can look it up. I think it just had the robot mode. I could be wrong. It came packaged in shuttle mode, but I think it was just the robot mode. Could be wrong. It's been many years since I've actually looked at the packaging. It's buried somewhere in my garage. All right, let's move on. Okay, here's another example of
my favorites.
This is the Hasbro Triptychon on the left, the Takara Triptychon on the right. Now, Triptychon, if you go back, Metroplex was created to be part of that Scramble City era combiners, the Aerial Bots, Protectobots, Stunicons. Before Transformers existed, those figures were already planned by Takara, and many of them had already been designed. And Metroplex was designed to be a companion piece to that. Now, I've never been able to find any research that would say Triptychon was also planned at the time. However, seeing that there are two different pieces of art, and there really would not be a reason for there to be two different pieces of art for this particular character, since they were basically the same. I have both the American and the Japanese Triptychon in the package, and I've compared both of them, and very, very little differences. It leads me to believe that it's quite possible that Triptychon was also designed prior to Transformers in some way, and this art piece was created. This art piece would be the only confirmation that we have of that, and it's just a theory. I can't confirm it. It's just my theory, having been a collector and someone who studies the history of Transformers art.
And we know that Metroplex, like you said, was going to be a Scramble originally, because he has those connector points on his legs that an aerial bot square pegged head could go in. But I'm just wondering if maybe they thought by this point, with Triptychon being motorized and all this point, that would be something they could drop off the play pattern without a negative effect. Also as a cost-cutting measure, which is why you really don't see anything on the artwork to suggest the Scramble City compatibility, because he had so much else going on at that price point, it really wouldn't have been a thing.
Yeah, if you look at the Hasbro version, it's very toyetic. You see a lot of the features the toy has. The Takara version is more stylized. It's more
dynamic
of the character, right. And then in base mode, you can hook up Motor Master and Onslaught to Triptychon, which adds more credence to the theory that it might be possible, it might be true that Triptychon was designed before Transformers. I hope there's someone out there who can verify that. I think next time I see Yoke-san, that's going to be the question I ask.
Who incidentally just retired, didn't he?
I thought he had retired many years ago, because there's a mandatory retirement age in Japan, and I think he had stayed on as a consultant. So I think maybe he had decided to step down as a consultant. I think.
Well, he's definitely given his more than his fair share of long hours and creativity to the line. So I mean,
absolutely. Yeah. And hats off.
Sensei Yoke-san is definitely the master, the Transformer samurai, the spiritual sensei of the brand, and he had touched so many Transformers throughout his career. Of course, he was going to be one of the first people inducted into the Hall of Fame.
He's the one that designed Sunstreaker, was he not?
That was one of the first Transformers he designed, and that was before Transformers became Transformers. That was back in the mid-70s, I think.
Yeah, because I remember I've got his autograph on a reissue Perceptor, along with Paul Lighting's autograph on it. And I remember as I spoke to him at BotCon in 2010, I asked him, you know, and he later confirmed this in the panel that he was in, that the work on that he the first one that he recalls doing was Sunstreaker.
Yeah.
So yeah. Oh, and incidentally, I did look it up, and Astro Train was a layered artwork in Japan as well. He had the train in front of him.
Thank you for getting back to us on that. So here we're looking at variations in art style and in coloration. And again, I apologize to our audio listeners. This is one of those slides you have to check out. You have to see what we're talking about. It's very crucial to this whole topic.
Goodbye, Megatron. Is that the blue one?
All right. So here we're going to start on the right. On the right-hand side, we have the original Hasbro. We have the Hasbro Megatron, which I believe was also used prior to Hasbro. You have Megatron and its classic colorations. Next to that, you have the Goodbye Megatron gift set, which was released in Japan for a very limited period of time. It had a Generation 1 Megatron and G1 Starscream in the box together. It was called the Goodbye Megatron gift set. And you'll notice that some of the colors have changed. Some of the detailing on the chest have been removed. And then next to that, you have a whole new piece of artwork. This was the Megatron that came in the, and correct me if I'm wrong, the VSX gift set.
I believe so.
This is a gift set that had G1 Optimus Prime and G1 Megatron in the same box. Again, only available in Japan, very limited piece, extremely difficult to find on the secondary market. It's a completely new piece of art. You see Megatron here holding his sword and holding his blaster, both of which were absent from the Hasbro version. Then you have, next to that, all the way on the left, in different colors, and with a repainted head. Actually, this would have been the original painted, because this came first. The Megatron from the original Takara release. The original Takara release of Megatron didn't have... It had the scope, but it didn't have the long barrel in the front and the...
The silencer equipment.
The silencer stock. And the stock. I'm not a gun expert. I apologize. I don't know the terminology. So this is the piece that came first for Takara. It was later redrawn, the head, for the VSX gift set, later released by Takara as part of the Goodbye Megatron, which I believe is the only time that piece of art was released by Megatron, by Takara in G1. And then finally, you have the Hasbro version. So this, to me, is the most amazing example of variations in Generation 1 artwork.
The angle on the head of the original Japanese one is just strange. It's like he's looking at you and... straight on, and the helmet head is not very apparent. It's just weird looking.
You can certainly understand why they would repaint that for the later release. And in fact, the colors, you see the red and the blue on the inside of the legs, those colors do represent the figure, the colors of the inside of the leg and arms on the figure in each particular box set. So the Goodbye Megatron does have the blue... legs and arms. The VSX does have the blue in it. So this is
different
truly,
shade too, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, you know what? It's everyone's computer screen is different. So and every piece of art is scanned in at a different
resolution. And everything.
Resolution. Yes. Thank you. So you know, don't go by what you see on the screen as far as you know how bright each particular piece was. So, this is an American variation, or rather a Hasbro variation. You had the original piece of art of Rumble Frenzy here on the left, as had been seen before Transformers. And then you have the painted over variation, which came in, I believe, Don, this was 87, the gold weaponed Rumble Frenzy. Is that correct?
To be honest,
or was it 86?
I never
came with Rat Bat, right?
I can't.
It was 87. I think this was 87.
Yeah. Because I'll be honest, I never all these variations and stuff. I never followed all the variations. Once I got the toy, I was pretty much done with the character because I just wasn't into and I didn't know about a lot of the stuff at the time. So
shame on you, Don, for not being a completist.
It's been a long time since
I broke into my collection. I had to sneak these in because my father didn't want me spending my money that I made on this stuff. So I had to sneak it in. So I really couldn't take a lot of chances on. You know, I had to sneak in copies of the comic in my school books because he did not want me spending my money on this stuff.
Hmm. So looking at this variation, the first version of Frenzy that came out had the silver weapons. The second version had the gold weapons. It was most likely the case that the original painting was painted over for that second release.
Buster and Hydra.
Moving on to some more variants. Now, we've talked about variants between Hasbro and Takara that have been two completely different pieces of art. As we get into the later years, this is 88, we're looking at Dreadwing and Buster? Or
Hydra, I believe. Buster was the Darkwing.
Okay. So this is Dreadwing and Buster?
Hydra.
Hydra, thank you. They are the same exact piece of art. However, only slight changes have been done to it. The Hasbro version is on the left, the Takara version on the right, and you can tell by looking at these that only one color was in fact changed, which is the blue that is on the chest. Even though the Takara version has a more significant color variation when you actually look at the physical toy, only some minor modifications were made to the piece of art. So it's interesting to see that in the beginning they made different pieces of art. Later on, they just reused the same art, changing it. And I think this adds to my theory that Trypticon was designed prior to Transformers existing.
I am wrong. That is Buster. I had to confirm myself.
Yeah. Now, one thing, Rick, I don't have the as much as I love Master Force, I could not at the time double dip on all this stuff when I found out about it. I just wasn't able to at the time. But Buster and the God of Master Brothers, were they only released as the gift set or were they released individually? And was there any changes between the two?
They were released individually.
Yeah, they came individually, and they also came in a gift set. Oddly enough, the gift set seems to be easier to find on the secondary market.
Yeah, but as far as the figures themselves, nothing. Was there any changes on the figures between the singles to the gift set that might reflect the artwork, or was all that just repackaging for different audiences?
I think it was repackaging. I've never had the single Buster and Hydra package from Japan to compare them to the gift set. I've only had the gift set. So that'd be interesting. I'd also want to look at the stamping on those figures to see if there is any difference on those as well. That's very good, Don. I'm going to have to screw you for making me go on another quest now. God damn it.
Sorry.
That's probably going to be like a 2-3 year quest now.
I have to honestly say, though, I do prefer Buster and Hydra's colors over the American ones. The red just pops.
Now here is the character, the companion piece to this, the Dreadwing and Buster.
Hydra.
Hasbro is on the left, and it's Buster. Did we confirm it's Buster?
The first one was Buster. I was wrong.
Okay, so this is Hydra. Yes. Thanks for messing me up. So this is Hydra. This is again 88. Takara is just simply reusing the Hasbro painting and taking some aspects that were blue and painting them red. And even though the actual toys had more differences in colors than what is shown in the packaging, they're investing less time or less money into making the packaging art that much more reflective of the actual product. I hope that made sense.
think so.
All right.
What the hell?
Okay. So, on the left, we have the individually boxed Motormaster artwork from Hasbro. In the middle, it's that same artwork, but the legs have been modified. The legs have been repainted, and this is the Motormaster, the Menasor gift set artwork. And then we have the Takara artwork on the right of our screen, and the legs have once again been completely repainted.
I've never seen the one on the far right.
Yeah, this is you can tell that they took a lot of care in matching the Takara to the Motormaster gift set box art. With the legs, it looks like maybe they just copied, like they cut out the artwork, lowered it, and repainted the black portion of the legs. Because the legs for the Hasbro gift set and the Takara release look exactly the same, except for the black connecting pieces of the leg.
Yeah.
And I would say that the Hasbro version is painted like this in the left and the center because of a common issue of packaging guys not knowing how to correctly transform figures and the designers not being there to assist them. Oftentimes, still to this day, you'll notice that some packaging from Hasbro has a figure miscorrectly transformed, or items at Toy Fair might be incorrectly transformed. That's because they're not transformed by the design team. They're done by the packaging team or the photography team. And they're not always experts in transforming things. So this is another one of those things where the version on the left, the original Hasbro one, most likely no longer exists. And even the part in the artwork in the middle most likely no longer exists.
Yeah, I always thought he had one of the derpiest looking box arts. But now that I see the Takara one on the far right, I actually like the Takara one. It's kind of jarring at first because you're like, hey, his legs kind of look right. But
yeah,
the more you look at it, it's like, this is more pleasing than the cluster on the left there.
Now, but, we're going to talk. I want to say one more thing about this. The reason they're the Menasor artwork from G2, which was never released but seen in the Legacy book, is brand new art, is because I believe this piece was taken by Takara and modified and stayed in Japan when most of the art was returned to Hasbro after use. So I think this is one of those pieces that if they modified it, they kept it. Mm-hmm. And that's why the G2 Motormaster art was completely new.
Well, it's almost like Takara was trying to emphasize the robot as a standalone character that just wasn't, hey, look, I'm a torso versus, you know, but on the gift set, that kind of makes sense because it sort of shows you what role he plays in the gift set. But the first one is so dark, you just lose so many details in it.
Yeah,
and if you actually look at the inside of the legs, there's a great amount of detail in there that's lost on the next version of it. They simplified it just a little bit more to look more correct, I would assume.
Yeah. The very original one kind of almost looks like what it would look like if you'd split an actual truck cab in half. You know, it's like you can see the bunk in the back and, you know, it's exactly like there's an actual cab in there.
Yeah. So, interesting. And this is the type of stuff we talk about where not everyone is aware that variations in artwork like this exist out there. So here we have... go ahead.
No, as I see, you know, that's why we need these books, is to sort of preserve all this, because with digital photography and Photoshop and everything, this actual physical artwork, sort of like what Crazy Steve was doing at Botlanta, you know, is when he was going through the ads, and he was trying to save all the original ads for Transformers. This stuff is going to be lost to the ages. This artwork is going to be lost to time, And it's a crucial part of the history that must be preserved. So, you know, books like this and, you know, people like you, Rick, that are basically, you're kind of like the gatekeeper, you know, you and everyone else that does this artwork book. So we need to remember this stuff because we're not going to have this great stuff. I mean, what we'll get in the future is nice, but we're never going to have this again.
And that's a great point. I mean, no one thought 30 years ago that this would have the following that would have, or have the cultural impact that it does.
Yeah.
And a lot of these original pieces of art were thrown away. And the ones that didn't get thrown away are locked up and have no monetary value at all to the owners at Hasbro or Mattel, Takara. And then there's some pieces which have escaped and then ended up in the hands of collectors. And there are some collectors that will share, hey, I have this piece, I want to share it with everyone. And there's some collectors who say, hey, I have this piece, I'm keeping it, I don't want anyone to know I have it.
Yeah, I'd love
it. And I know collectors from both sides.
Well, the parallel that I draw is this to me is just like Doctor Who. There is so much of William Hartnell and Patrick Troughton's early years, the first two Doctors, that was lost to time, no pun intended, when they just destroyed the tapes. And if it hadn't been for little broadcasting booths in Australia or somewhere in Africa where these tapes, where these reel-to-reel tapes are still in canisters undiscovered for 20, 30 years, I don't want to see that happen to the Transformers artwork from the day. I don't want to see us lose basically what you would say 84 to 86 artwork like we did with Troughton and Hartnell. So, you know, that's very important to me that we don't lose this stuff because of negligence or stupidity.
You know, as you said, Don, Rick, people like Rick is the gatekeeper. Who is the keymaster?
There is no keymaster, and that's the problem.
There is no keymaster. You know, there needs to be someone. Rick, let me ask you this. Has Hasbro ever given, while you were there, did they ever... when all this was starting, when this nostalgic was kicking in, when the importance of the Transformers history was kicking in, did they ever have like a chief historical officer?
Someone who cared about the old prototypes that were sitting around and the old artwork that was sitting around. Someone that came before me. And he was good enough to lock it all in one room at a facility. He left Hasbro, I would say maybe a year and a half before I started working there. And I kind of took up on my own where he had left off. And I talked to a couple people. I went around and I asked people, hey, do you have this? Do you have anything in your desk from previous guys whatsoever? And I was lucky enough to find a bunch of stuff. And I also locked it away. And there was a ton of stuff that was in my office, which had never made it to that secure facility. And a lot of that stuff, fortunately, was probably thrown out. So there is some stuff there. However, no one at Hasbro feels that they can monetize it. You know, you can use it for a book, but then what do you do with it afterwards?
Yeah. Well, you know, and this is something I'm going to bring up, not just to Transformer fans, but your Power Rangers, your Ninja Turtles. If you are a collector of anything, Hot Wheels, and there is a history involved, I mean, like even Power Rangers, you know, has gone back to, you know, it's getting its history, you know, behind it, you know, Ninja Turtles, other stuff from the 70s. If you are a collector and the history of your product is important to you from both a nostalgic standpoint for someone, say, my age, and just from being able to have this available for future people to enjoy, I would say no matter what you collect, get with the company, get with the manufacturer that makes your product and tell them, hey, preserve this history. And again, I'm using the title I just made up, Chief Historical Officer.
Here's the thing, though. What monetary value does the company have to gain from that? Let's just leave it at that and move on.
Okay.
Is we could have a whole show on that.
Exactly. Exactly.
I will tell you another story. You know, once ARC started being on CDs, a lot of those CDs were just laying in piles. And I went through thousands of CDs. I'm like, oh, here's the Energon Cybertron ARC. Here's the Energon Landmine ARC. And I would just ARC, and I had a huge, huge box filled with thousands of CDs, a box so big we couldn't even move it. It was just the ARC from Energon, Armada, Cybertron that got all thrown out, unfortunately.
Well, say your problem was it wasn't on microfiche. I'm kidding.
See, kids don't know what that is. All right, let's move on. Okay. Here we have Pretender Starscream. This is another piece that was layered to a point. And what I mean by that is that the jet was painted, and then the robot was painted with the Pretender behind it. So the Pretender was never fully painted. The robot was painted in front of it or the Pretender behind it, and then cropped for either the individual carded release,
the Legends version,
Kmart, the Legends version, or the Takara version, which did not have the shell and came in the gift set with Bumblebee, Grimlock, and Optimus Prime. Or, I'm sorry, Bumblebee, Grimlock, and Jack. So this is one of those things where, like, the reverse is true. They didn't layer this one, but the jet in front of it is layered.
Yeah.
It looks like there was an added effect there, maybe? No, I guess that's just the leg of the Pretender, I guess.
Yeah, yeah. Well, if you look at the right, at the Hasbro Pretender shell art, yeah, there is an effect of, like, ghosting the art to make it look like it's going from the person to the...
Sorry, I got a YouTube video trying to play on me here. Go ahead.
Okay. All right. Let's carry on. Differences between characters, which were later reissued by Takara and not reissued by Hasbro. Here we have the Hasbro art for Soundwave, and then on the right hand side of our screen we have Buzzsaw, along with Sound Blaster, which was a Soundwave toy, just with a larger chest, fit two tapes in its chest instead of one. This is a character that never was released by Hasbro back in G1. This was exclusive to Takara, and Takara, this is what, 87 Don? Takara actually took the time to create a new piece of art rather than take the original piece of art and repaint it, which is odd because following this in 88, they would just take the Hasbro art and slightly recolor it.
Yeah. You know, on this, I actually like both pieces. They're, you know, it's just, you know, it's the Sound Blaster version is a little more dynamic.
Yeah.
But I like the pose that Soundwave's like, you know, I'm just gonna stand here and beat you to a pulp. You know, he's just, you know, that calm, cool, aloof kind of Soundwave that we're used to. You know, and in this case, I like them both equally for different reasons.
And it's amazing that this is the same toy, just two different styles, but the later style, the Sound Blaster, is trying to emulate that original pre-Transformer style in its design. Okay. So I find this completely fascinating.
I want to share something here, too. It's, you know, one of the things I like to, I alluded to earlier, if you haven't seen what some of the things I've been doing, I'm going to screen share with the viewer.
Do I have to do anything on my end?
No, I'm just going to screen share it. A recreation that I did of this particular artwork, the Sound Blaster. And hopefully it's not bogging everything down. I'm getting a spinning beach ball here. But you have the artwork on the left, and then my attempt at recreating it on the right. I just love the pose that they used on this. It's just gorgeous. But all right, back to showing you guys.
All right, am I good?
Yes, you're good.
Okay. Here is another take on the difference between Hasbro and Takara. This is the same toy, only it's been slightly remolded. And Takara has now taken the opportunity to create a whole new piece of art. On the Hasbro side, you have Crossblades. And this is the layered piece with the helicopter in the background, the jet in the front. And then the Pretender and the robot are most likely one piece. So you have three paintings here to create Crossblades. The Takara version of Blue Bacchus had a remolded face, a remolded chest, and was there anything else different with that, Don? Was there?
When I found out about this guy existing, what he was going for back then, I said, I'm never going to have one. And
that was probably the closest Don ever got to saying F that.
All right. So the Crossblades was never released by Takara. Thus, they would never have had this art. The Blue Bacchus was a retool of Crossblades, which never saw release by Hasbro. So Takara made a whole new piece of art for this. Because it's a completely Takara original art piece, I would say it's most likely layered, but I can't confirm that. Because if you think about what this is 89 now, you think about what Takara was doing in 88 with their art and what they did in 87 and prior to that, it's very possible that by 89, this was one piece of art rather than two pieces of art layered.
Yeah.
Just an observation. I can absolutely be wrong.
Oh, Metro Titan.
So we have here Metroplex and Metro Titan. The Hasbro version here on the left, Metro Titan was a completely new character by Takara. It was released, when was this, Don? 1990 or 91?
It was right towards the end, right before Brave started kicking in. So I would say no later than 91, because Metro Titan was out for Return of Convoy or Battlestars.
Right. So Metro Titan is a repaint of Metroplex that came with a few extra little parts, a little ramp and a little Micromaster. And never saw release outside of Japan. So this is Takara product. So instead of taking this is 1990, 1991, instead of taking the antiquated art of Metroplex, which if you look at the other pieces of art released around Metro Titan, the Micromasters, the Micromaster Combiners, which were exclusive to Takara, characters such as Star Convoy, that was a much stylized and updated form of art. This vintage Metroplex piece would not have fit in with that. So they created a whole new piece of the same toy. And again, it's beautiful to look, but this is the same toy, but two completely different expressions based off the same figure. I hope I explained that in terms.
Makes sense. I mean, both of them have their charm, but you know, one is just actually more aesthetically pleasing than the other. In my opinion. Right.
One is more toyetic, basic, right off the toy, even the articulation of the leg on Metroplex versus Metro Titan, which is dynamic and represents things which a toy cannot do. And the end here. Here we have Kits, and on the right we have Battle Gaia, which was a very late release by Takara, a repaint of the Combaticons. So this is a completely new piece, and if you look at this compared to the Bruticus, the legs are arranged differently, the pose is different. Everything about this is differently, yet, to me, whoever did this particular piece, I think was still trying to emulate that old style.
Yeah,
maybe not so much in the chest.
But it's like the angle is there,
right? It's like the little details in the swindle, in the brawl, in the Battle Gaia. That's just so reminiscent to me of G1. They're a bit more simplified, but I think the big difference here is that you actually see all five characters, whereas in Bruticus, you're really not seeing Blastoff at all.
Yeah, he's covered up by the gun. Mm-hmm.
And again, these are the same exact toys, just complete and different interpretations, which to me is beautiful. So now we're getting into G2, and we're closing in on our presentation. By this time, it was becoming more accepted for Hasbro to take existing artwork and just repurpose it. So here you have the Dreadwing smokescreen artwork repainted into the Megatron Starscream ATB bomber. Now, at this point, if you look at G2, other artwork was being reused. You had the GoBots from Generation 2, which reused the same artwork. You had some of the Laser Cycles, which used the same artwork, just colored differently. And these were also actual paintings. But by this time, they had the ability to copy that painting and just paint a new one. So I don't believe the actual Dreadwing was painted over to become the Megatron.
Getting into the age where you could actually use computer recreation of the images.
Right. Technology had advanced to the point where you didn't have to destroy the original piece of art. However, by Generation 2, and this is a perfect example, you still had people taking original Generation 1 artwork and repainting it. Actual painting.
I would have loved to have that Mirage.
So that Mirage is one of the pieces that I found at Hasbro, and I was able to photograph that with Jim Sorensen and use it in the Legacy book with Jim and Bill. A prototype of this did exist. It was a hand-painted prototype, and I'm going to tell you a very sad story about that prototype. So I was traveling with two buddies, Paul Hitchens and my buddy Mass from the UK. They came to BotCon 2007, and I had rented a minivan, and I was driving them down from Rhode Island to New York City. So they were going to spend a few days in New York, and then from there they were going to go back home to the UK. That weekend, Maz had purchased the G2 Mirage prototype from someone. And he wrapped it up in a plastic bag and put it in the back of the van. It wasn't until he was in the UK that he realized he didn't have it with him. And I returned the minivan to the rental car place, which means that prototype was probably thrown in. It was broken in half, so it probably just went right in the trash. Told you it was a sad story.
Well, now, you know, I'm just wondering if with this artwork being available, if we might see someone like Ocular Max, because they've already done the Red Mirage from their Sphinx mold. So, you know, we still might be able to get this through a third party representation, like, you know, Ocular Max or something. So that's one thing about the third party. You know, we've talked about this before. Things we'll never see from Takara or Hasbro, and a G2 Mirage, I don't think is at the top of their list. It should be, but
it would be amazing. I think at one point we talked about this for BotCon, and then we decided it was too out there.
Yeah,
because I think we had done a few other things, like, you know, we had met with interesting success with like the Astro Train that we had done, that it was supposed to come out, it never did. So, I mean, there are some differences between this art and between the G2 and the G1. So it leads me to believe that this was either damaged or just someone made a decision to paint over it in a very extensive way. If you look at the legs, they're very different. The hand position is different. One has an open hand, one has a closed fist.
And even his number is different for some reason. It seems like you would
188 versus 26. Yeah.
If we're looking just at the art and not the colors of it, you know, there are some differences in the face as well. So here we have G1 artwork versus unreleased G2 artwork. This is a hotspot. This is one of those figures that I found at Hasbro. I can tell you that the G2 Devastator was never created. It was never painted. And the any G2 combiners, the full figures, were never created.
As far as the artwork,
a Menasor, G2 Menasor artwork was never created. G2 Devastator, which saw release, was the artwork of Devastator himself was never created. And I know that because I actually talked to the gentleman who painted the G2 Constructicons. He was still working at Hasbro. he had a few of those in his office desk. So we're looking at G1 Ramjet, G2 Ramjet, which was painted over the G1 Ramjet, and then you have Sandstorm, which was an unreleased G2 version, painted over that. There was also another, I believe it was the original Starscream art, which was painted over to create a like Black Ops version, a very dark black and dark blue version of Starscream, which never got released. And we're almost here at the end. And my computer has frozen. Oh, hang on. Sure. We'll wrap it up with these guys. Whoops.
Energon Galvatron.
Okay, so we'll just wrap it up with these guys. You have the G2 Optimus, Laser Optimus on the right. You have Machine Wars Optimus on the left. The Machine Wars Optimus was a repaint of...
Thunderclash,
which was only released in the UK, which means it did not have any artwork that was inspired by G1, because at that point the art style had already switched. So they simply took the Laser Optimus Prime artwork, repainted it, and cropped it, and created that Optimus Prime artwork for the Machine Wars Optimus Prime, even though that piece of art looked nothing like the actual figure. And it was my hope at one day to take the G2 Laser Optimus Prime and actually release him in these colors. Unfortunately, that never happened. And we'll end with these guys. Leader Class Megatron from Energon.
Yes.
And Leader Class Energon Optimus Prime. These were supposed to be for the Universe line. Artwork was created. The figures were created. But they never got released, along with a number of other pieces from Universe. There are there's so much more that we can talk about when it comes to art and Transformers. But this is only a 2-hour show, and I think we fit our limit for the show.
We're about an hour and a half, which is about our average.
Yeah,
I do want to
say. Today being, WrestleMania and the season finale of Walking Dead, I have to go prepare my body for that. Yes. So,
but I do want to state that by the time this episode is uploaded to YouTube, I will have all the artwork that was shared on this episode for the video viewers and everything. If you are listening to the audio version of the podcast, feel free to go to TFYLP's Facebook group page, which is facebook.com/groups/TFYLP. If you're not a member of that, shame on you. Join up. We'd love to have you. You can follow along with us on your mobile device or whatever you're listening to us on, and you can actually see the images that we're talking about on here and follow along with us on there. Hanzo?
This is Titan's Return.
Or Titan Returns.
Miss Shot. I'm sorry, Six Shot.
Miss Shot.
Yeah.
But
Upside Down Submarine.
Yes. Yes. Nobody ever calls it.
Yeah. The code name for him in the development was called Green September.
That's right. I get that one, Don. I get it.
Wah, wah, wah.
All right. If you have any artwork out there, please share it with us. Share it with the world. I have a few pieces, and I like to share them with people.
Yeah.
If you're looking to unload some original vintage Generation 1 artwork, and you feel free to give it to me, I would be happy to take it because I would give it a very loving home.
I've been known to pay for my artwork. So.
Yeah, and also,
I'm a broke MF-er, so I can't do that. So,
But also the fact is, if anyone out there does have artwork, contact Rick or Duron so they can get in touch with Jim and everybody. Because I'm sure if we can get, I'm sure there's enough artwork out there for another book as a way to preserve this history. Which is really, you know, after seeing Steve's presentation at Joanna about, you know, even just the print ads and us losing all this history, like, again, like Doctor Who, the first two Doctors, I don't want to see all this stuff go away. So I want it to try to be preserved as best as we can.
Well, it's also important to note, too, that it's a preservation of a part of history. When, you know, toys now aren't, I don't think they're the same. I mean, I know some kids play with them still, but I don't know if the same level of imagination with the toys is applied as it was whenever we were growing up. Simply for the mere fact that modern toys are mostly posable. Whereas Generation 1 toys, bricks, you know, a lot of it, you really had to use your imagination to know that this toy, or to play with this toy and imagine it in these dynamic fight scenes, standing there in this dynamic pose. And the artwork that came on the box, especially for me as a child, gave me a mental image of what this character particularly was supposed to look like. And I'll use an example, Flywheels and Battletrap. The Duocons. The toys were stumpy, didn't really have any legs or feet to as a toy to speak of because of the way they're transforming gimmick. But if you look at the box art, they are very interesting and dynamic looking on the box art. And if you played with the toys like I did, you know, you could, it the artwork helped extend my imagination. And that's something that I think is lost, is a lost art, you know, artwork. And I love the fact that it's really made a comeback with like the Combiner Wars and Titan Returns and the fantastic IDW art that is now included on the packaging. It helps draw you back into the world of Transformers and give you the imaginative seed, as it were. In my opinion, I mean, that's the way I look at it. What do you guys think?
That's kind of, that's similar to what I've said about like the BotCon sets, of how the fiction, the comic, that one box set is its own universe, and everything has to work together to flesh out this universe as one shot in existence. And I think the artwork, the way we used to be with the artwork telling you the story about the character, whether they were like the good with the evil, whatever the case may be, I think the packaging should tell its own story. I mean, yes, you're going to have these characters that you can find out about watching a cartoon, reading a comic, but I think we need to remember that some of these characters aren't going to have these stories to be told, or they're going to be a background character or a one-time character. So I would just like to see the card they come on, the artwork represents a character and tell the story of the character, and the back of the thing be about that character as well. But again, that's like the old, like you were saying, the old school, that's all you had on the box was what you had.
Yeah. You know, one more quick time for those of you who aren't familiar with this book, you can get it on Amazon. It's by Jim Sorensen and
Bill Foster,
Forrester rather. The Transformers Legacy, the Art of Transformers Packaging. I got this on Amazon. It's about $30, but it's a good, nice, sturdy hardcover, and as you can see, inside full of gorgeous vintage artwork for Transformers, and it really, really shows you a piece of the history of this wonderful brand that we all love so dear.
I just want to end with we all collect for different reasons, and we all collect in different ways. I just want everyone out there to respect the brand they collect.
Absolutely.
Whatever brand that is, respect its origins, respect how much work has gone into it coming to market, and if it's standing up to the test of time, such as a He-Man or Star Wars, Transformers. Now, appreciate the legacy, even if you're a newer collector, if you're someone who just got into the Transformers for the movie or for the new cartoon shows. It's important to know history.
Absolutely. Now, next week, kind of change gears here a little bit. We've already got a topic lined up for next week. What type of collector are you? What type of Transformer fan are you, I guess?
I'm a man. I'm a male Transformers collector.
Are you a collector? Do you consider yourself a collector, a super collector? Do you consider yourself more of just a fan of the lore? How do you fall? How do you define what type of collector you are? We're gonna talk about the different types of collector and look at those next.
I better be on that show. I've got a massive amount of opinions on this whole subject. Yeah.
But be thinking about that. We'd love to hear your opinions on that, the listeners. You can, like I said at the top of the show, tweet us at TFYLP on Twitter or post it on Facebook group. Or you can post it on our Patreon page at patreon.com/TFYLP. We'd love to hear from you as a fan and listener.
Stop by Don's house. Or Duron's
apartment. And if you do stop by Don's house, bring him the gift of Cheetor. Supreme class Cheetor.
Or if you stop by my house, bring pizza and beer.
Okay, yeah. And then leave. I want the pizza. I'll take a pineapple and ham. I don't want the Cheetor. The Cheetor will maybe lose my appetite for the pizza, and then I'll have to give the pizza to Massey. Then he'll get all fat. It's just a vicious cycle, all caused by Supreme Cheetor.
So what you want is a Supreme Cheeto.
That's about what he is.
All right, guys. Cheeto. WrestleMania awaits. Okay. The Walking Dead await.
All right, guys. We will see you next time on TFYLP. Don, thank you. Rick, thank you for all the great slides there. Those will be up on the TFYLP Facebook group. We'll see you next time on TFYLP.
Take care, everybody.